Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Tournament Center. I'm Brian David Marshall, and I am here with Michael Hetrick, a.k.a. Shippenhalla on Magic Online. We're at Pro Tour Born of the Gods in Valencia, Spain. And Michael, you chose to come to the modern format with a living end deck.
That's right.
You said, you know, you did some testing, but it was mostly to sort of eliminate some fringe decks. You were going to play a good deck.
Right.
And this is what you consider this to be a good deck for modern.
For this format, yes.
Why this format?
Meaning that now that it's more of a creature format with Zoo, and there's not a lot of graveyard hate being played.
Right. Now, it would seem to me, let's take a look at this first slide and start looking at what makes a living end deck work. And really, it's these like cycling creatures. Deadshot Minotaur, Monstrous Carabid, Architects of Will, Jungle Weaver, Pale Recluse. So you're cycling these in, you're building your mana. But it would seem to me like that this deck would be really good because there's no Deathrite Shaman. Is that what the decision was?
That's not exactly the case. I like this deck with Deathrite Shaman, and I actually hoped that didn't get banned because Deathrite...
That seems counterintuitive
it,
to me.
It is weird. Deathrite only gets rid of one creature at a time, so you can just play around it, and your opponent has to leave open mana and Deathrite every single turn, and you just don't do anything until turn three or four, and then you have three or four guys in the graveyard, and they just have Deathrite, and they haven't really progressed their game.
Right.
And then you cascade.
Okay. Well, let's take a look at some of the other creatures. It's a pretty straightforward deck. Street Wraith, this is another card. You get to cycle it for free, which seems to be like, it would be a very efficient use of your time.
Yeah, the part of the reason these cyclers are good is because, and Architects of Will, or Thought?
Yeah, Architects
of Will. Is good in this deck is because you can do it on turn one, and on turn two you can cycle two of them. Like, Jungle Weaver is not very good because it costs two mana. And you really have to have that high velocity and get the graveyard into critical mass zone really fast.
Sure. Simian Spirit Guide, what is this? This is letting you do what?
So this card is not necessary, but in some matchups, it's really good. Sometimes turn two, you do need to cascade, even though it's pretty rare. But a lot of the time, it's just a surprise, like, they could have Mana Leak, but you have Simian Spirit Guide, or they have Spell Pierce.
Well, we saw you pay for a Spell Pierce with it last round. That was really pretty exciting.
I put him on Spell Pierce, and I waited till I could do it, and I had Spirit Guide to do it. And that worked out really well, but I still lost.
Shriekmaw, so I guess I assume that this is, you can evoke it, put it into your graveyard, and then when it comes back, it gets to kill something that maybe it killed already.
Yeah, it usually kills the same thing it killed before, but it's just a way that you can actually do something that interacts before turn three, because
okay.
Like you can't do anything usually until turn three.
And I imagine you have to get rid of Scavenging Oozes, too.
The Ooze is actually a perfect example for Shriekmaw being good.
And then Fulminator Mage seems like an amazing card to me in a format full, you know, this is a format that's been falling victim to Blood Moon all week. I imagine that means there's lots of targets.
Yeah, Fulminator, because control matchups, most of your cards don't do anything by themselves. Fulminator lets you interact in another way by blowing up their lands and giving you something that they either have to counter, which is good for you, because if they counter your Living End, you lose. So they probably have to counter this card, or you just leave it in play and blow up a land at the opportune time, and then Living End.
Okay, so if they don't counter it, you get to force them... You get to force them to keep just all their mana up, or...
Like, if they do have a counter and they choose not to counter it, I just leave it in play. Now they have to have an extra land open every turn.
Right.
And if I ever get to a point where I can just sacrifice it and cascade without a counterspell, then I get it back, and they're going to be really far behind.
Right. Okay, so let's talk. We've been talking about cascading. We've been talking about living in. This is what's going on here. This is what it is.
This is the card.
Each player removes all creature cards, which is interesting because it affects cards that are indestructible or...
Oh, that's from the graveyard.
Oh, okay.
But
yeah,
sacrificing...
Sorry. Sacrificing,
right.
Yes. Sacrificing all creatures he or she controls. So if for some reason there was a Thassa that was active, they would have to sacrifice it.
I think there's a few things. I can't think of them off the top of my head. Like if there were Darksteel Colossus from Polymorph.
So, and then all the creature cards come back.
Right.
But you've stocked your yard with those Pale Recluses and
those really bad creatures.
All these like kind of just like, you know, middle pick draft cards.
And then, yeah, the critical mass is really what matters, and the fact that you kill your opponent's creatures. So you have like 9 or 10 power, maybe more.
Right. And then so you can't cast this spell.
You can't cast that?
No one can suspend it.
Nope.
Have you ever suspended it?
Not in this tournament, but it is semi-common against blue decks where you go really long.
Okay. But instead, what you do is, because it costs nothing, You cascade with, you have 2-3 mana cascade spells that are cascading for cards that cost less than it, and there's nothing else in the deck that's going to cost 2 or less.
Exactly.
So does that prevent a challenge when you're doing deck building? I mean, is there, are there cards you like, you're like, oh, I wish I could play this?
Well, in some cases, yeah, but the way the deck functions, it's just not something you really need. Like,
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, you do have the Shriekmaws. That's the one loophole you have.
Right.
And that's mostly because, like, sometimes there's Scavenging Ooze or decks are just too fast.
Right, because you couldn't play a Doomblade in that spot.
Yeah, you can't play
Doomblade. You would never want to cascade into Doomblade.
Exactly. And Shriekmaw works, it just so happens it works really well with Living End, too.
Right. So you get all those creatures back, and then usually what's your board position look like at that point?
In a really basic matchup like Zoo, I mean, their creatures just died. You have, 10 power in play. And I mean, that's it.
And that's it. And you can just attack. And even if they, they've also spent their hand, they've expended their energy.
You've cycled your cards. So you've exchanged yours one for one, and theirs just died, and yours just came back. So you have actually up cards on them.
Sweet.
And then in some cases, Zoo, their creatures are actually pretty big. Tarmogoyf could be as big as yours. In that case, the game's going to go longer, but you still have a huge advantage.
Right. Now, have Violent Outburst or Demonic Dread ever won you
frequently
a game using something? Really?
Yes.
So creatures you control get +1/+0, or target creature can't block?
Yeah, it's usually just in the situation where you have your guys in play and you're just finishing them off. But sometimes it actually matters. You have to kill them this turn for whatever reason.
Right. Sometimes you have to drive in a nail with a shoe.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure.
Okay, let's take a look at your mana. Verdant Catacombs, pretty straightforward.
The mana base overall is really straightforward.
Yeah.
You have the 4 catacombs, and your duels are going to follow. Grove is new, actually. It used to be Copperline Gorge. And because in some games you have to cast 5 drops, you don't want to be like tap land on turn 4, tap land on turn 5.
Sure.
So Grove is for that. And then Cliffs is just perfect because it cycles everything on 1 mana, the Architects and the other 2. And then Wolf Run is like really fringe. It's just like how you have to use the cascade cards to win sometimes. Wolf Run's for the times when you have just like one guy in play and you're going grindy and you need to kill them with it. So you like pump it for 3, that's 6 damage.
Right, okay.
And then so on.
Let's take a look at the rest of the lands. So Blood Crypt, Stomping Ground, Godless Shrine, Overgrown Tomb, just...
Yeah, one of each. You can't really afford to play 2. You don't want to take a lot of damage because you have your Street Wraith also.
Right.
Godless Shrine is for Pale Recluse, and then a sideboard card, Sin Collector.
Okay. And then let's take a look, just a couple basics.
Yeah, one of each basic.
Have you found yourself under any kind of Blood Moons so far?
Not today, but if you know about it, it's really, really easy to play around with this deck because you have 4 Recluse and 4 Catacombs and 2 basics.
So you can get the basic lands you need to operate. And then just looking at the sideboard, Ingot Chewer, Sin Collectors, and Jund Charm.
Yeah.
What are these for?
The Chewer's pretty, it's a staple for this deck. It's for Relic, Progenitus, and Affinity. I mean, it's just like Shriekmaw in that you can cast it on turn 1 or turn 2.
So you kill their artifact creature, and then it is just the red Shriekmaw against artifacts.
Yeah, it's perfect too, because if you don't kill a creature, you get to kill an artifact when it dies and an artifact when it comes back.
Right. Sin Collector?
There's like a few things you could do with this slot.
I've heard about you going on the Sin Collector beatdown plan.
Yeah, I like this guy specifically because it forces your opponent to either counter it or just takes a counter out of their hand. And then it's still a guy that can attack them. And, you have the Wolf Run. So if you get really grindy, you can do that.
Right, you can go black, white, red, green, X.
Yeah, sometimes it's kind of bad, but the mana works out eventually. And then it's also a target against the decks that don't have creatures for your Demonic Dreads.
Okay. And then Jund Charm?
Jund Charm is kind of a catch-all. It does a lot of different stuff. But usually it's going to be an instant speed Pyroclasm.
Right. Okay. But I mean, I also saw you, you were playing against Affinity last round. It was kind of a rough matchup for you because the etched Oracles were there.
Etched Champions
were there, sorry. And the
Ravager.
Arcbound Ravager. So, you could not really effectively Living End ever.
Those specific cards together, I really have nothing I can do. I tried to get him to a point where he didn't have 3 artifacts, but I wasn't able to do it.
Right. You basically needed the Jund Charm.
Well, I needed the Ingot Chewer.
Oh, or the Ingot Chewer.
Yeah, it didn't come.
All right, let's take a look at some more sideboard here. Flipping ahead. Next slide, there we go.
Okay.
So 2 more Shriekmaws, 4 Leyline of the Void. Is this a card maybe you bring in against Affinity?
Yeah, this is something I don't usually play with. I usually play Macabre, which I do bring in against Affinity. But this one, it just so happens it's good against Storm, which I would otherwise beat Cold too. I would lose. And I did beat Storm with Leyline. It just so happens. Against Affinity, Travis Wu's told me you can cast it on turn four and still not lose, and then the Ravager is done, is it, you know, irrelevance.
Right.
But I didn't believe him, but he might be right.
Okay, and then let's see, I think is that the rest of the last of the sideboard cards?
I think that's it.
Okay, so now I have a question for you. I've watched you play this deck a couple times, and honestly, what it seems to me is the way the ideal plan for your deck goes is your opponent plays Rest in Peace. You cast Deadshot Minotaur, and you attack them to death.
I wouldn't call it ideal. I'd call it possible.
Sure. So what I'm saying, though, is that it's still, even with, like, the best sideboard hate, you can still find a way to win with this
There's still plans to beat it,
right.
Even though I can't destroy it.
And you can still cascade into Living End and then
right.
just treat it as a straight
it's a wrath.
Removal spell.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's interesting. I'm excited. You got a couple more rounds to win,
yep.
So maybe you can get your best finish in your Pro Tour career.
Hopefully.
This will be very exciting. For Michael Hetrick, this is Brian David Marshall signing off from the Tournament Center.